Welcome, my friends. We're going to address a question that has come to us concerning the 144,000. This group of people are mentioned a few times in the Bible. The two best known are in the book of Revelation. Once is in the 7th chapter of Revelation, and the other one is in the 14th chapter. And I want to read a few of these verses so that you will be able to see just exactly what the Bible is saying about this group as we look at who they are and their specific function. And in Revelation chapter 7, it says, "After these things, I saw four angels standing on the four quarters of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor the sea, nor on any tree." This, in its prophetic setting, is dealing with the angels of God holding back the winds of war and strife. But that is a totally different study for us to do. But here, as these angels are holding these things back, John says, "I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads." So God is holding back all of these cataclysmic events to take place on the earth until a specific event happens, and that is for his people to receive his seal in their foreheads. And then he says he has the number of those that were sealed. And this is what has caused confusion for so many. It says, "I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of all of the tribes of the children of Israel." And then he goes on and he enumerates, "Of the tribe of Judah, 12,000, Reuben, 12,000, Gad, 12,000. He says, "Asher was 12,000, Benjamin, Naphtali and Manasseh, Simeon and Levi," and as he goes on through here, "Zebulun and Joseph," these were all sealed. He ends with the one of Benjamin. Now, first thing to notice is that these are not the 12 tribes of Israel, not the literal 12 tribes of Israel, and that we'll discuss a little bit later on. So these 12 tribes with 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes, he says, are the children of Israel. Now the next mention is over in chapter 14, and in the 14th chapter he says, "I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven as the voice of many waters and as the voice of a great thunder, and I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sung as it were a new song before the throne, before the four beasts and the elders, and no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth." So this 144,000 who received the seal of God, who stand before the throne of God, are those who will be redeemed from this earth. Now it goes on and says here in verse 4, "And they are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the firstfruits unto God and to the Lamb, and in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God." The next several verses now present the message that these 144,000 are to give to the earth, and this message is generally referred to as the three angels' messages. So as we look at this 144,000 now, there are many today that believe that this number is a literal number. And I want us to take just a few minutes to think this through rather rationally and see why this cannot be. There are several reasons that the number cannot be literal. First of all, we are dealing with a symbolic prophecy. This is not a literal description of things. It's a symbolic prophecy where we find that there are symbolic winds that are being held in check while people receive the symbol of God's allegiance to Him. So to take this one portion or the number and make it literal in the setting of everything else being symbolic is to really distort the scriptures after the manner of Procrustes. Second, if we take this figure literally, we're going to see that there are only a literal 144,000 people who will live through the last great conflict. That would mean that there are only 144,000 living righteous at the second coming of Jesus. Now, I have no problem with it being only 144,000 or more or less. Remember, the last time this earth was destroyed, there were only 8 that came through. But that would mean definitely that only 144,000 living righteous at the time of Jesus' coming, if it's taken literally. Now also, here's the part where you would have some real problems. Of that 144,000 living righteous, every one of them would have to be a literal Jew. So there are no living Christians that are righteous at the second coming. And that would, to me, presents a real problem. Exactly 12,000 from each of 12 non-existent tribes. And that would be an impossibility. If the tribes don't exist, how can there be 12,000 from each of them? And all the 10 tribes, 10 of the 12 tribes went into captivity in 722 BC with the Assyrian captivity. And then after that, the Babylonians and the Roman diaspora completely eradicated the lineal, the tribal lineage. And so there cannot be 12,000 from 12 tribes that do not even exist. Now, if these were the 12 literal tribes, then we would also have to understand that there would not be one soul saved from the tribe of Dan, which is not even mentioned. So again, we see it is not the 12 literal tribes. And in addition to that, Levi and Joseph, which neither of the two were of the 12 tribes, are both mentioned in this list. So again, clear evidence, this is not talking about literal Israel. The Israel that God is interested in are those that Paul talks about in Romans chapter 2, when he says, who is a Jew? Well, he's one whose circumcision is inwardly. He says in chapter 9 of Romans that the circumcision of the flesh doesn't do anything. Not all that are of Israel are Israel. So the true Israel of God today are those who have accepted Jesus Christ and whose hearts have been changed by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's why in Galatians he says that as many of us are baptized into Christ have put on Christ. You know, I think I would like to read that one to you. It's in the book of Galatians. So as we go back to Galatians here, we'll see clearly what God says about who the Israel of today truly is. In Galatians, in chapter 3, Paul says, "For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus." He's not writing to Jews. He's writing to the Gentiles in Galatia. And he says, all of you are, notice this, all of you are the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized unto Christ have put on Christ. Very important. Now watch. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So there we see it's not dealing with Jews, it's dealing with those who belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. And a final evidence that this prophecy cannot be taken literally, we read it in Revelation 14, where it says, "For they are all virgins, for they have not been defiled with women." In other words, if we take it literally, there are only 144,000 people saved when Jesus comes. Of that 144,000, there's exactly 12,000 from 12 non-existent tribes. And every one of those 144,000 are literal Jews, and every one of them are virgins. You see the absurdity of trying to twist this, rest it into a setting that it is literal. For if one takes a number as literal, let me run this by you one more time. There would only be 144,000 righteous when Jesus returns. All of these would have to be Jews coming from 12 non-existent tribes, and every one of them would have to be virgins. And in order to be consistent, the position would have to be held that the four literal angels, there are four literal angels holding back four literal winds, while God's people receive a literal mark in their foreheads that contains the literal name of God. And such thoughts are positively preposterous. We are the Israel of God. God is trying to tell his people that when he comes back, not one believing, dedicated, consecrated child of God will be lost. We will be able to all go home with him if we have received the seal of God. And that's the important thing in this whole presentation of the seal of God. What is that seal of God? Because without it, we cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. It is so important that Paul tells us in Ephesians 4:30, "Grieve not the Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption." We must have the Spirit of God seal us. And again, in Hebrews chapter 8, the Apostle Paul gives the call, "Bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples." That's Isaiah 8. Seal the law among my disciples. Well, now we see that the law of God and the seal of God are closely related. And that's why Paul now says in Hebrews 10, "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people." That is the significance, friends, of the 144,000. We will do another discussion soon on what this seal of God is that we must have if we are going to be ready to meet Jesus when this war and strife comes and Jesus comes bursting through the clouds of heaven to get his people and take them home. And friends, it is my prayer that each one of you will be ready and waiting when he comes, that you will be able to lift up your heads and see him coming and say, "Lo, this is our God, and we have waited for him, and we shall be glad and rejoice in his salvation." God bless you.